Today is our fifth lecture, and from the previous one, we has discussion about a very important measurement in a very complex structure, such as the arm of the excavator. We cannot use our mechanics of material knowledge to determine the stresses in the material of that excavator. So in many experiments, we got to use strain gauge to measure the deformation in the form of strain. And then we have equation in the chapter 2, transfer the strain into the stress. And then no matter is the stress or it is the strain, we can do the transformation as we have discussed before. Strain gauge is invented in 1938 by Edward E. Simon and Arthur C. Lurke. This is the most common type of the strain gauge. The picture over here, there is the foil, and then covered by the plastic, and then we attach the strain gauge into the machine or the structure. When the machine or the structure subjected to force, there is deformation, and then the metallic foil over here will change the resistance, and then there is what's so called the strain gauge indicator. So you can read the strain from that one. And we have discussed about the example from our PowerPoint today. I like to show you, demonstrate you how do we calculate the strain gauge problem by manual. Let us consider the problem that we have. We have the strain gauge over here, and which we call it 45 strain losses. And I suppose to mention one thing, when you have the strain gauge losses, you got to put one axis at the reference axis. Usually we put the horizontal one, and then by putting this into a material point on the structure, that means we are measuring the strain at that material point. It can be like in a beam, or it can be like in a machine, in a car, in any subject, okay? Especially the one that cannot compute by using the stress analysis method. And then by doing this, when we let the B losses as our plus axis, from the measurement, we get the strain of the strain gauge A to be 300 micron. What is 300 micron? In our civil engineering, it means this strain gauge occur at the strain A has the value of tension 310 - 6, and with the unit millimeter by millimeter by millimeter, or it can be meter by meter, but depending on what you are convenient to use it in your practice. And then this one, strain B, this one, it has the positive, that means also it is intention. And then the strain SC has the negative, that means the strain over here has the compression, okay, is negative side. Then we may convert this set of epsilon A, epsilon B, and epsilon C into a more convenient strains that we use to use this in the XY axis, which are normal strain in X direction, normal strain in Y direction, and also the shear strain in the XY plane. And then we have what? We have the strain transformation equation, the form of strain transformation equation. You can find it in our books or in our PowerPoint, okay? You can set like it's going to be epsilon sub A equal to epsilon sub X and cosine square theta sub what? Theta sub by itself. This one epsilon, sorry. We looking for what? Cosine theta. Let us go to the equation that we have in the books, okay? And you can take it. Let me check it in the PowerPoint that we have to make sure it's correct, okay? We can go a little bit further to our equation. So this is going to be the equation, okay? That is epsilon sub A equal to epsilon sub X theta sub A square plus epsilon sub Y and psi square theta A and plus gamma sub XY psi theta A and cosine theta A. That is for epsilon sub A. And for the epsilon sub B, things are in a similar manner, but change the angle from the theta A to the theta B. By doing this, you may just write only one equation and use it as the reference to our computation. Now, what we have is epsilon sub A. M sub A is here. Let me put epsilon sub A in, let's say this one. And by doing this, what we have is the rotation that we have over here to theta sub A is clockwise. When it's clockwise, we have theta sub A to be minus 45 degrees. And by doing that, you just plug this one, 300, and then micro, and then that's equal to epsilon sub X, okay? And then that is going to be cosine square minus 45 degrees plus epsilon sub Y psi square minus 45 degrees, and then plus gamma sub XY psi minus 45 degrees and cosine minus 45 degrees. You may put everything together. You will get this one to be like 300 micron equal to what is cosine minus, this is supposed to be 0.5 epsilon sub A plus 0.5 epsilon sub Y. And this one is when you time it, you supposed to get one is minus, another one is positive, right? And then you supposed to get it to be, let's say, minus 0.5 gamma sub XY. And then there is epsilon sub B that you may select. Let me put it into the yellow. The epsilon sub B is over here. And then we have the theta sub B equal to 0 degree. And by doing that, if you do the same computation, you supposed to get this is 180 micron. And then it's equal to what? It's equal to epsilon sub X cosine square of 0 degree. Okay, this is going to be 1 and plus epsilon sub Y, and that is going to be psi square 0 degree. This is supposed to be 2, 0. And then we have what plus gamma sub x y sine 0 degree and cosine 0 degree. Okay, when you multiply it, this one 0, and then now you get epsilon sub x to be what? To be 180 micron. Okay, and you can, if you like, you can put it over here. Okay, and then that equation will be like a 140 micron, right? Half pocket. And then if you move time kit 180 micron divided by 2 is 90, and you move it, this is going to be 120 micron and equal to 0.5 epsilon sub xy minus 0.5 gamma sub xy. And then there is the last one that we consider is going to be epsilon sub c. For the epsilon sub c, let's put it this one, and the rotation of this one is up here, so theta sub c is going to be plus 45 degree. And then by using the same computation, you will get minus 250 micron for epsilon sub c equal to now you have epsilon sub x, and then you time this one is cosine, that is 180 micron, and cosine square 45 degree, and then it's plus epsilon sub y time what? Time sine square 45 degree, and gamma sub xy sine 45 degree cosine 45 degree, and then you get it to be what? This one will be 90, and if you move it to the left, it's going to be minus 340 micron. Okay, and then you get this one to be 0.5 epsilon sub y, and this one going to be positive 0.5 gamma sub xy. And let's say this is equation one, this is equation two. Okay, so equation one and two, so we have minus 130 f sub y is going to be, oops, sorry, minus 130 micron, and gamma sub xy is minus 550 micron. And I should say something, this one in the unit of radian, and this one may be unit of millimeter by millimeter. So you got the result, okay? And just put epsilon sub x to be plus 180 micron millimeter by millimeter, and epsilon sub y to be minus 130 micron millimeter by millimeter. And the last one, shear strain, gamma sub xy minus 550 micron and unit of radian. Okay, please help me just put the result into a proper position. Now they ask us to determine the principal strain and its associated direction. By doing this, let me put this one as the A, and given this area over here to be the B. And for the B, we're going to use the Mohr circle. Okay, so by using the Mohr circle, we got to determine the center. That is going to be C of what? Normal strain average, and then zero. So based upon this, we got to get the center,
at the what 180 micron and minus 130 micron divided by 2, and then we got it to be like 25 micron and 0. That is going to be the center of our Mohr circle. And then the radius, okay, the radius is going to be the square root of epsilon sub h minus epsilon sub y divided by 2 square, okay, and then plus this one, beware about it, gamma sub xy divided by 2 square also. If you plug everything into this one, you're supposed to get it. This is going to be equal to square root of epsilon sub x is what? Over there, take it over here, 180 micron. Minus, and then minus. It's going to be the strain minus 130. So it's going to be, and then divided by 2 and squared. And this one supposed to be 550, even though it's negative, okay, divided by 2, but it's half squared. So the negative change to the positive, and then you get this one to be 315.67 micron, and in the unit of radian. Now you're supposed to put this one in the circle, and you got to have a good estimate. What we supposed to have, let me put one in this one is going to be the normal state, and another one, let me put it over here, that is going to be shear state divided by 2. And I do some workout, and I think we supposed to select a proper scale. Let me check. This is 1 centimeter, 2 centimeter. Okay, let me put this one for 100 micron, 100, 200, 300, because we have 300, right? And then 400 and 500, that is going to be 100. Let me put it in the micron, millimeter by millimeter. This is 200, 300, 400, 500. And then on the other side, you also have this one to be minus 1, 200, 200, 300, 400, and 500. And on this one again, that is going to be 100, 200, 300, and 315. That's really nice. 1, 2, 3, and this one maybe 400. Okay. And then what is going to be 25? The 25 supposed to be 2.5 millimeter from here. So mark it. And then you get this one, 25.0. And please put this one in micron of the radian. So when you put the micron over here, you don't put, you need to put 25 micron, just put the number 25. And now you got to use your compass. The radius is going to be 315. That means you guys gonna work by putting this one, and then it's going to be about 31.5 millimeter like this. And now you get this one, you plug over here, and you draw the small circle. Okay, that is going to be a good one. So take this compass with you to our room, and then what you get, the maximum Okay, on the right hand side is going to be principal normal strain epsilon 1 and 0. And again, on this side, that is going to be normal strain number 2 and 0. And you may see this is going to be 25 plus the radian. Okay, so when you plus 25 with the radian, you get 25 plus 315.67 and 0. And then you get this one to be 340.67 and 0. It is in tension. I mean, it's going to get elongation. And then on this side, you got to have it 25 minus radius. So 25 minus 315.67 and 0. And then you're supposed to get it to be minus 290.67 and 0. This is the contraction. Okay. And what is the status of your referent? The status of the referent is going to be this one, epsilon sub x and gamma xy divided by 2. So it's going to be 180 positive minus 275. Okay. That is going to be minus is supposed to be somewhere here because this is minus gamma over 2. And 250, okay, and 275 is supposed to be somewhere here. And then you may draw the line parallel to the the normal strain axis, and you supposed to get this one. And also you need to determine what 180, so that is going to be about this point, and then you may draw the line up there, supposed to get the point somewhere over here. Now this is what this is 180 and 2 minus, sorry, minus, this is minus divided by 2 minus 275. And what we get is the state of strain, okay, that occur on our referent axis. And then if you guys like to determine the principle, they are associate direction. Okay, associate direction over here. You find what? You find this one. The associate direction supposed to be so to theta sub p1. But if you like to have this one, it's going to be 2 theta sub p2. But it is more convenient to determine 2 theta sub p1, which is the associate direction to the strain number 1. And it's rotate what? You can see it's rotate clockwise. Okay. And then basis upon this one, you have this one for what? This one you have 180. And how about this one? This is going to be this, sorry, this is this is 275. This is going to be 180 minus 25. Okay, so we have this one, 180 minus 25. So we have 10 2 theta sub p1 is 275, and then divided by 180 minus 25. And if you put it, you're supposed to get 2 theta sub p1 equal to 60.6. Okay, I got 60.3. You get what? How come? Let me check 60 point. No, I got 60.1, 60.2. 60.15. 3.6. Okay, if this is 60.6, theta sub P1 supposed to be 30.3. Okay, we got this one. Now we just know this is going to be in clockwise direction. So you go up over here and theta sub P1 is plus 30.3 degree with the clockwise direction. And you got the stain, stain 340.67 micron. And stain number two is going to be minus 290.67 micron. Okay. And then there is no gamma for the principal stress. Principal strain, there is no shear stress and shear strain respectively. And can you draw the picture of this? Okay. I like you guys to let me have the element. Let me put the element over here, and let the axis here is X and here is Y, and we have let's say a unit of certain element. This is one unit, and this is supposed to be what we have. Okay, and then the stain, the axis must rotate, okay, in the what, in the clockwise direction. So it's rotated by 30.3. You can have this one, make it the reference. Where is the 30? This is 30 and 0.1, 0.2 and 0.3. Then you get this one as the principal one axis, okay? And then you also have this one as the principal two, oops, sorry, two axis. Now your element change, okay? Let me write the original one first. We have one unit and one unit, 1 centimeter. Let's say this is the old one, right? And then what we have over here also 1 centimeter. And then it's like this, is rotated like this. But when it's rotated, it comes with the elongation in the one direction. So by doing this, it has 340. Let me put it like 340. Let me put 340 for about 7 centimeter. Okay, this is going to be something move in this direction. And then for this one is what? This one is 290. So the scale is no good because if I use this scale, this one will be really small. But anyway, let me put it like this. The element gonna be something like this, okay? It's elongated in the one direction and it's contraction or shortened in the two direction. This is the new state of our element for the principal strain. And then if you prefer, you may measure this one. This is what? This is the angle associated with the maximum, sorry, maximum gamma max divided by 2. If you draw the line over here, you may draw the line on the bottom also. You get the coordinate of this point. And the coordinate of this point is gonna be 25 and the radius. Okay, and this one is negative. Okay, 315.67.
If you like, you may measure it for another 45 degrees here. Okay, and then you get this one to be 2 theta sub S1,
and the coordinate here is 25 and positive 315.67.
So it's up to you. You may select this one. If you do this one, you get the total angle is 90 degrees, right? So you get 2 theta sub S1 equal to 90 degrees minus 60.6, and then theta sub S1 supposed to be 45 degrees minus 30.3 degrees, and then you supposed to get this one 14.7 degrees. Okay, that is indeed this direction, counterclockwise direction. But if you prefer this one, you will get the angle rotates like this. You will get theta sub S1 is 90 degrees plus what? This is 90 degrees, right? This 90 degrees plus 60.6 degrees. So theta sub S1 150.3. So it's going to be like 75.3 degrees and rotate in this way. So let me put it in this direction, because drawing the positive shear strain is going to be easier than normal drawing the negative shear strain. Let me put the angle to be 75.3. So we rotate 75.3 about here. So this is going to be the axis that produces the maximum shear strain. Okay, and then you got to actually draw in the different area. This is not a good area to draw. By doing this, let me put it, okay? Let me put it over here. We can do a small, let's say, let me put it here. Let me move it on the top, can I? This is going to be our X, Y, and then we got to rotate 75.3. That is going to be this new, this one, axis. And then you also have this one. And again, you have the reference element, like 1 centimeter here, and put this one in 1 centimeter. And then what you get? You get every strain to be 25. Guys, that means it's both 25. So it's get elongation like this, the first step. This is going to be the average strain. And then you have the average strain and also the positive shear strain. The positive shear strain, you got to put it this way. This one supposed to have rotated, but in this way, and this one also should have this one. And since you have this one, you also need to put it in this manner. So this is going to be both. First, this is average strain, and the combination of this side and this side is going to be shear strain. So this is a new feature, okay? The shape of the
of the material point when you consider what when we consider the state of maximum shear strength and we may need to put this one also. This is going to be theta sub S1, which is 75.3 degree. Okay, and also for this one, you got to say this is going to be theta sub P1, and this is 30.3 degree. Okay, in the stress also, you need to do so, but I have the YouTube for the undergraduate level. You may go to the mechanics of material. There is chapter, I think chapter 9. You may go to my YouTube and that's where you can have a review on stress transformation. This stress transformation is untypical. We didn't teach here at SUT. That's why I show you guys to do so. Okay, that's what we have for the examination last year. Let me move a little bit back to this one. Okay, we discussed about this example already, right? And I like you guys to go through it, review it. Okay, it's not that hard to do so. And let me move the discussion to the small displacement theory. Again, in civil engineering, what we design the structure is we put the structure in the linear elastic behavior. In the linear elastic behavior, we consider what? We consider sigma sub y as the strength of the material. And next chapter, you will see this stress occur with the strain, let's say for the steel, very low. It's in the range of 0.001 to 0.0015. That's typical for very small displacement, okay? And based upon this one, the strain of the fiber in one plane are not influenced by the out-of-plane displacement. What I'm saying is the line O2 here, after deformation, it just has rotation. The line is still straight line, not curve, okay? No curve. And this is the first note on this. The second note, undeformed geometry of the body can be used when we writing the equilibrium equation. So for the linear elastic behavior, when we consider, for example, the beam that's subjected to the force, we can find the reaction of the beam, okay, based on the free body diagram and based on the equation of equilibrium reference to its original length. For example, if this is 2 meters, we still use it as the 2 meters. And then based on this one, with the conclusion, the stress and strain has the linear relation. And then Hooke's law comes, stress equal to modulus of elasticity times strain, okay? Or for the shear stress, it's going to be shear modulus of elasticity times shear strain, okay? And then we can do the mathematics, and then we get the strain in X direction is the rate of change of the displacement in the X direction with respect to the X. And we use the partial derivative because
you can be the function of x and y. And then for absence of y, we do the same thing. And the shear strain is going to be the angle here. And also the thrust of the angle here. And then when you do it, the shear strain going to be curl u by curl y. This portion is the curl u by curl y. The displacement in x direction with respect to the y axis. And if you consider in the other direction, you can see this is the displacement in y direction or v with respect to the position in the x. Okay, you got this term. It's kind of combination of the angle, the red angle with respect to the light blue angle, and the combination provide you with the shear strength. Okay, and then if you consider in the c axis, you got three more equation and a total of six strain related to the six stresses. Okay, and in the strain computation and for the linear elastic, again behavior, we can do the first order approximation. Based on this, we may approximate this equation by this one. We may set delta to be 0.001 and set the n equal to 2. By doing this, you may get the comparison between the left terms and the right term. They're different in the 0.00001 or 10⁻⁶. So they approximately equal, okay? And the other thing, if you put the angle in the radian, again, you may use your calculator for a very small 0.001 radian on the left hand side, you get this value. On the right hand side, okay, this is going to be compare this one. That is very close to 0.001. You may minus this, it's very small. 10 like a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 minutes, 10, something like that. And for the cosine and for the tan, we can prove it. Okay. And then there is the application of the average normal strain. For example, if you have the cable link between point B and point C, the steel arm AB very limited compared to the cable BC, since the sections are so different. When you move, okay, the steel arm AB to A B palm, you may imagine CB will change to CB palm. And by the definition of the average normal strain, you may have what? You may have B palm C, that is on the right picture, minus B C and divided by the length BC. Length BC is 2L and 2L is okay. But what's going to be B palm C if the rotation is very small 0.002 radian? We can do the mathematics computation, okay? And the first thing I should mention, the length AB, after you rotate it, the dash blue line on the left picture and on the right picture, they are the same. They are L, okay? And what's going to be the difference? If the L putting in the cosine, you get the line, the red line over here. Okay, that is L cosine theta. And when you put it in the L sine theta. You get this one. Now, what you get is the horizontal length is going to be 2L plus L sine theta. Okay. And then there is the small length here to compose into the tight angle. Okay. That is going to be L minus L cosine theta. And then when you square it and take the square root, that is going to be B prime C. The mathematics behind it, okay, needs some approximation. If not, it's going to involve with complexity, okay? And when you expand the term inside it, okay, this is going to be the term here. This one and this one will change to one. This is positive one and positive one plus positive one and plus four. Okay, that's going to be what we have. That is six. Okay, six. And then four sine theta and then minus two cosine theta. The complexity come over here, but we can reduce it from the previous first order approximation. And we have cosine theta equal to one and sine theta approximately into the theta. Okay. By putting in the form like this, we can approximate B prime C in the form of this one. Or you may like it. This is going to take at the end since theta is very small for the first order approximation. You get the equation in a simple form as this one. So based on the approximation, CB prime is going to be 2.002L. And that's going to minus 2L, right? This is the final length minus original length and divide original length. You get this one to be 0.001. And for sure, due to the tension, this one will get elongated. You get the elongation of 0.001. Okay, this cable have the normal state of 0.001. And then we come to a small piece of element. And before this, I like to show you guys a little bit, one more thing. Pinapa, Ajahn, mention about the pad over here, the black one. That's usually we call it neoprene bridge bearing. We use this one for what? During the construction of this elevated highway bridge, okay, we construct the cross beam on sides. And during the construct of this cross beam and pier on side, we cast this precast beam in the factory, and then we ship it onto the big truck. And then when we install them, we require to have this pad in order to transfer the force from the beam to the cross beam effectively. If not, if you put the concrete onto the concrete, there are stress concentration and they may cause a lot of crack, okay, occur in the concrete. With this kind of pad, the stress transfer is going to be smooth, okay? It's kind of, you have the pillow, transfer your head, okay, onto the floor, something like that. And then I said, this kind of pad must be tested and typically is supposed to have a typical shape like this. And the pad subjected to the vertical force due to the weight of the beam, due to the weight of vehicle. And then the vehicle also handbrake on your structure. When the structure breaks, they're supposed to have the horizontal force. And see, there is the shear deformation occur over here. So this is a kind of thing, and then I like to take you guys back to our problem. I like to relate what we have over here with the real application that we have in the construction of the elevated highway. Okay, as an engineer, okay, you may require to consider the bearing, the composite rubber bearing. And let's say we start with the one with the gray color. And then after the application of the force, the point D change to D prime. The point C change to C prime. And the point B change to B prime. We like to find what? We like to find average shear strain that occur over here. What's going to be the average shear strain? It's going to be the angle on this side plus the angle on this side. Okay, let me put it like alpha 1, and this is going to be alpha 2. This is going to be alpha 1 plus alpha 2 in the unit of radian. Okay, and then what is going to average normal strain on side AD? We may consider by the concept. On the first one, side AD has 400 millimeter length. And later, the size AD change the length, follow this line. And then if you use the light blue length minus the green length divided by the green length, you will get this one, okay? And the last one, what is going to be the normal strain on the diagonal DB? Again, before the change of shape, DB is this dashed line. You can see it's going to be 400 on the vertical and 300 for the horizontal. This side going to be 500 millimeter. And then after the application of the force and the deformation occur, we have what? The D change to the D palm and the B change to the B palm. The brown line is shortened compared to the black dashed line. So we may compute the normal strain by minus the brown line by the black line and divided by the black line. That's the concept, okay? And in this one, again, shear strain is going to be the angle alpha 1 and alpha 2. How do we compute alpha 1? Sure, we have this one for 3 millimeter, and we have this one for 400 millimeter. So we can find the first one by this equation, okay? Arc tan of 3 divided by 400. On the other side, they have 2 millimeter over here, and then divided by 300 millimeter here. Then you got alpha 2 from the arc tan of 2 over 300. And then you get all of this in the radian unit. Don't forget to set your calculator in this radian unit, okay? If not, you're going to make a mistake. And then, as I mentioned, for the normal strain for the line AD, we got 400 millimeter for the AD. This is 400, this is 400. And what is going to be AD palm? Okay, that is going to be 3 square plus 400 square, and take the square root. Now you get the result easily. It is the elongation of 28.1 micron. Okay, and the last one, again, as I mentioned, original length is 500 millimeter. So the dB over 500 millimeter. This is 500 and this is 500. You got to find what? D palm, B palm, this one. And again, you may go to the engine static using the law of cosine. This is law of cosine. If we know this size, and we also know this size, and we also know this angle, we can determine the side that's in the opposite of the angle. So this one we are looking for. And then we know B already, right? From the previous slide. How about the A? The A is going to be this one, 2. And this is 2 square plus 300 square and take the square root. So this is A D palm. Previously we have. And for the A B palm, this is 300 square plus 2 square. You got this one. So what's going to be the angle alpha? The angle alpha can determine easily because of what? Because previously this is pi over 2. And we know alpha 1. We also know alpha 2. We just subtract the angle pi over 2 from our shear strain. Shear strain is this one plus this one. So you got the alpha. Now you got to convert it into the angle, follow the law of cosine, and then you will get everything and you get D palm B is 496.6014. Is shorter than 500 millimeter. So the strain is going to be negative. That means in this direction, the normal strain is in contraction. Okay, get the negative side and you get the value of it. Okay, I coming on this point because I like to review about what you supposed to know, and actually it can relate to our work, okay, in the construction of elevated highway or even for the high speed train, for the path that I just show you guys. And I will upload the pictures for you in order for as the reference. And then there is some important thing about the strain. We know the force must be in equilibrium. Okay, when the force is in equilibrium, the stress acting on the area or on the material point of the structure must be in equilibrium also. Okay, that means stress certify the equation of equilibrium. Okay, with reference to the consider of forces and moment. For the strain, there is the strain compatibility condition. Okay, that the strain must satisfy. If not, that strain is impossible. If the strain satisfy the strain compatibility condition, okay, the strain is physically possible and we can determine the displacement and the rotation of the given material point correctly. And based upon this, there is a lot of derivation occur in the textbook. If you prefer, you can go through all of that, okay? The thing is, the displacement field corresponding to strain must be single value. It cannot have two value for a single point. Okay, the deflection for a point can move to a given typical position, no overlap to each other, and it must be continuous because strain is going to be partial derivative of the displacement with respect to x. In order to be able to compute, the equation of the displacement must be continuous. Okay, and when it's continuous, it's supposed to be derivative. I mean, you can find this mathematics function. And by doing this one, you may go to the textbook and you will get the set of strain compatibility equation. And this important, we will use this set of equation later to check whether the displacement field for the structure is okay or not. And then come to the last example of chapter one. We're going to consider the three-dimensional problem. Let's say we have really big, okay, three-dimensional element, which close to what we have in the example, the rubber pad. And then for this, the point E have deformed and moved to the E star. And we supposed to set the displacement over here is going to follow the small displacement theory. And then the displacement function is given by the constant C1 times the coordinate x, y, z. And also for the displacement in y direction is here, and the displacement in the z or z direction is here. So the function of the displacement is x, y, z times the constant. What is going to be the constant? Okay, we got to find it. So the first one, we determine the state of strain. Before we can determine the state of strain, when E star given here, we got to determine C1, C2, C3. And when we know C1, C2, C3, we know the function of the displacement. And then the state of strain, for example, epsilon sub x will be curl u by curl x, epsilon sub y, curl v by curl y, and epsilon sub c, curl w by curl z, and the shear strain also. And then after we get all of the required strain, we got to check whether the obtained strain of strain is followed or is in accordance with the strain compatibility relation or not. And based on this, okay, we have the new coordinate of point E, okay? Before this one, point E is 1.5, 1.0, okay? 1.5, and then 2, okay? Compared to this one, the X is going to be elongated. The Y, the V, the displacement in Y axis, going to be elongation, and W is going to be contraction, okay? And then U is 0.004 and positive. The displacement in X direction, the displacement in Y direction also positive, and the displacement in Z direction is contraction negative. And it is important because follow the equation that we have, we get U, V, W, okay? And also we get X, Y, Z. Since X, Y, Z is the coordinate, okay, that occur here, so we can determine C1, C2, and C3. When we get the constant C1, C2, and C3, we got the displacement function U, V, and W. Now, we have the small displacement theory. Okay, we can determine the strength, 6 of them. That is normal strength in the X direction. Okay, we have this equation. And if we like to compute at the point E, we got to put the value of X here and C here, and we got this one, maybe in millimeter by millimeter or meter by meter, whatsoever you like. This is small strain. See, 0.002, consider small. Strain in Y direction, strain in C direction. So we got 3 normal strain, and we can see all of them are small. And this one in elongation, and this one in the contraction. And for the shear strain, gamma sub xy is positive and is supposed to be in radian. And gamma sub xc also, please put the radian onto it. Okay, and the last one, you got this one. And again, all of them are small strain. And then we're going to check the equation of the strain that we have, follow the strain compatibility or not. Okay, and then by doing that one, we may prove the strain of strain at point E in accordance with the strain compatibility, because it is zero equal to zero. Okay, zero equal to zero. It's linear strain. When we do the second partial derivative, the result is zero. Okay, that means for very small strain, what we have is the displacement function UVW, okay, are what's so called in accordance with the strain compatibility. So that is chapter one. Let me take you to the second chapter. But before I go to the chapter two, I should mention something. The construction material that we use in our civil engineering application, some of them, such as steel, such as cement, Portland cement, it got to follow some kind of standard. In Thailand, we have Thai industrial standard. When we buy steel, the steel must follow that. And you got to check, for example, the yielding stress, the ultimate stress, the modulus of elasticity of the steel, and the percent elongation. Okay, for example, if you like to buy the deformed bar and it has the symbol of SD40, that means this sigma sub y supposed to have like 400 megapascal, and sigma sub u may have like 600 megapascal, and the E supposed to have 200 gigapascal, and percent elongation supposed to be larger than 20%. Okay, that mean what? That mean you must have some kind of knowledge on the mechanical property of the material. And that's why we supposed to study this chapter. And to get that mechanical property, we use the universal testing machine and SSUT. We have some of them. This is at F6. It costs about 8 million baht. Like 15 years ago. And also this one we have in our lab, F4. And this one also cost us like a 4 million baht. And also we have this one, 3001, in the F5 building. So as the civil engineer, first you got to have the knowledge how to test the material, follow the given standard in your country, okay? And then as a civil engineer, you also must be able to test the structure, okay? And that can be beam, that can be column, or that can be beam column. In our lab, we also have the what's so called the loading frame. This loading frame was designed and supervision in the construction by me and a number of our graduate students by using this frame, at least two of my PhD and about 10 of my master's degree, and a lot of Dr. Suksan also use this one. We do testing the precast beam a lot in the past, but nowadays our activity just down because when COVID come, things gonna get slower and we didn't get much job from the company. Anyway, there is two kind of tests, one for the material, another one for the structure. And for the material, again, you should be able to use the universal testing machine. And actually in next trimester, we have the course of material testing. You may come and join us and learn about the material testing in accordance with high standard. And based upon this, you will use the UTM. UTM will provide me with the stress and strain and follow this kind of standard test. Okay, you will get the stress strain diagram. Now, the stress strain diagram show us the stress strain relationship. And the stress strain diagram for a given material, such as aluminum, different from steel, different from the concrete, different from the wood. So stress strain diagram is a kind of signature for each type of material. And you got to test it, follow the standard of each country. And since the standards is legal, so all of the construction material must follow that. And then when you get the stress and strain, when you put everything together, you're going to get stress strain diagram. I should mention about in the undergraduate degree, you will get this kind of stress strain diagram. We call it engineering stress strain, okay, diagram. And that stress strain diagram come from these two equations that we discussed before. What is it? Is the stress is the internal force divided by original area, no matter the material has the decking or not. Okay. And in reality, the material after it passing the yielding, which is very small portion over here, the material starts to have the necking. I will show the picture of necking later. So the stress going to be true stress. The true stress is can be derived by putting them with respect to the original length. You may see the true stress is the engineering stress times this factor. And this factor always equal to larger than one. That means true stress always equal or larger than engineering stress. Okay, but don't worry. In our civil engineering application, we only consider the structure in this elastic region. So in actuality, we never consider the true stress. Ajahn, how come you got to learn it? We got to learn it because we are in the master degree level. you got to know a little bit more compared to the undergraduate, okay? And then the stain also, you may use the D2 stain equal to DL over L. And by putting the integration, okay, you will get the two stain in the term of ln. So it is ln L divided by the LO. And then for the engineering stress strain diagram, okay, we may use what we have in the lab number 3 of the material testing. And you can see the demonstration of testing of this D4 bar. Just copy the link here and go to our Facebook group of the mechanics of material. You may add yourself to that group, okay? And by using your real name, your real face, and certain ID, you may enter that and learn what we have for the video clip, okay? And for the stress strain diagram, since you have kit before, I should ask you, when you plot it, okay, there is two scale. You may call this one the upper scale, or some people call it rough scale, okay? And you can see from this one, you can determine sigma sub u, which is important in according to the TAS. But you cannot find sigma sub y, and you cannot find the modulus of elasticity because that mechanical property must be determined from this small portion of the stress strain diagram. So you got to zoom kit and use another what's so called the lower scale and compare the scale, compare the lower scale with the upper scale. That is going to be 200 times zoom. Okay, you just take 0.1 divided by 0.001. It's going to be 100. So you get this graph. Now you may see clearer the first portion of the graph is linear, okay? And the last point, that's this stress strain linear or follow the Hooke's law is the proportional limit. And since the definition of proportional limit is not clear, but if you a little bit go further, the definition of the yielding is clearer. So most of the time we use these 2 points, okay? The same, use the same of these 2 points. And then now you can determine the yielding stress, which assumed to be the same point as the proportional limit. So in the design, we can use this Hooke's law, okay? If not, you cannot use this Hooke's law reaction. You can use this only the proportional limit. And then you, based upon this, you can determine the modulus of elasticity as the delta of stress divided by the delta of strain. Then you get the modulus of elasticity. Now you can use sigma sub u, sigma sub y, and E, and also the percent elongation. Okay, you do the test and compare it with the standard. And if the result from the test lower than, even though each one of them, not 4, only one of them lower than the standard, you must reject that material, turn the material back to the manufacturing company and ask them to send a new one in order us to follow the standard, okay? And then there is two important things about the behavior of the material. I supposed to show you guys a little bit. there is the elastic and plastic and bases upon this one. Let me show you guys about the rubber band. You may see typically for the rubber band, let me put this one like a 4 centimeter, see? And if I elongate to 6 and I release it back, it's returned to its original length. That's called elastic. However, there is another property called plastic. Let me put this one as a reference, okay, 4 centimeter again. Now I pull this one to 6 centimeter and then I release. It's returned back a little bit. And now you can lift it. It's 5.3 millimeter. That different between 4 to 5.3 is 1.3 centimeter. We call it permanent set. And the value that's returned from 6 to 5.3 is called elastic recovery. Okay. So this is a kind of behavior of the plastic. And you can see the permanent set that's occur in the plastic, but there is no permanent set occur on the rubber band. Then by doing this, there is some special consideration on the behavior of the material. Actually, Pheng Lapha have this one already, but I supposed to review it. Based on the elastic behavior, which is the behavior that we use in our civil engineering application, then the first portion is linear elastic up to the proportional limit, okay? And then the curve just get a little bit curved and reach the elastic limit. That's going to be very close to the start of the yielding region, and that is the upper and lower yielding. We use the lower yielding as the sigma sub y of this one. And then what happened in the yielding? The stress still there, not changed, still sigma sub y for the mild steel. And there is a lot of deformation occur until the end of yielding. What happened here is the rearrangement of the grain of the steel. Because when we manufacturing the steel hot cool down. During the cool down process, the grain randomly form, and with the stress of sigma sub y, the grain can rearrange itself to a more compact manner. And then after this point, okay, from the yielding stress, there is a large deformation. At the end of yielding, the material can take more stresses and down. You can notice for the steel, the necking occur. Okay, and when the necking occur, if you divide it by sigma equal to P over A sub O, you will get the engineering stress strain diagram. But during the day, you use the vernier, which is very hard to do so. Measure the real cross-sectional area of the specimen. You will get the two stress strain diagram on top. But again, we don't care about that because we, as the civil engineer, we use the material only in the elastic manner. And also in the design, we use what's so called the allowable stress, which is yielding stress divided by factor of safety. And factor of safety can be as large as 2.0. So our structure we have only in this small region. For the author, we reserve it, okay, for the safety of the structure. And then it reached the ultimate, which is the largest stress the material can take. Okay. And after that, the necking appeared to see clearer and clearer until it reached the fracture point. We got KIT as the fracture stress, and the last portion we call KIT necking. Before the last portion, we call KIT strain hardening, because the strain during the yielding caused the hardening of the material to taking larger stress in that portion. And then this is the pictures of the necking, okay? And I should say, under the tension test, what we have is we pull this one, and the stress that occur over here is a kind of normal stress equal to the force P divided by A, okay? You apply the more stress, but it's cause necking. Necking is a kind of slipping or sliding of the grain of the steel. What caused the slipping or the sliding is caused by the shear stress. It's very strange. Ductile material such as steel subjected to the normal stress fail by shear stress with this kind of angle, which is 45 degrees with respect to the line of loading. And then it's cracked like this. Then please take a note on this one. Okay, typically with the ductile material, the necking over here before failure must be very clear, and it's also indicate the large deformation of the material. It's good, okay, for us to see, hey, this one have large deformation, so let us escape out of the building, those kind of thing, okay? And this kind of ductile material, especially the mild steel, have this kind of stress strain diagram. And again, I like you guys be able to determine important mechanical property based on our Thailand industrial standard. Okay, and that is going to be able to do so. And also there is explanation why we use only first portion, very small, okay, over here, because strain at the end of yielding, even though this one, the stress didn't increase at all, okay, the strain here is large, which is 20 times larger than the original of the strain. So the design code specifies the yielding stress as the strength of the steel. Since beyond this point, the deformation of the structure will be very large, and the function of the structure, okay, will be failed, or the structure cannot function as desired. So that's why we use sigma sub y as our strength in the design of the steel structure. Now there is another real graph. Okay, I just take from some reference to show you guys my steel has a clear yielding point. Okay, such as in Thailand, the deform bar SD30 or SD40. You may see the yielding point very clear. And then you can see elastic portion is very, very small compared to the plastic portion. So when the structure get large deformation, that is a warning sign. Okay, the structure is not safe. And then what going on during the yielding? In theory, we said the yielding is just the deformation without increase of the stress. But in reality, you will see there is a shaking of the UTM during the yielding of the material, okay? This shaking is due to the movement of the grain, okay, of the steel. And then the failure of the yielding, sorry, the failure of the steel is due to the yielding. But after the yielding, there is the slipping of the plane of the steel gate. And that means the steel subjected to normal stress fail by shear stress. And it's at 45 degree with respect to the line of force. Okay, this is going to be 45. However, there is another important material such as cast iron. Since Thailand is in the development of the high speed train, and that means we must develop the rail of the train. And when the train, the wheel of the train, the wheel of the train is cast iron. Why? The wheel of the train must be in cast iron because cast iron have very strong surface resistance. And when the wheel made by the cast iron, the rail must be made by the cast iron. If not, when the train break, the cast iron will clutch with the steel. And since the steel have lower surface stiffness, so the rail surface will what's so called wrinkle and cannot be used, and you got to fix it. That's why the rail of the train must be constructed by the cast iron. But the cast iron comes from the steel, and then you put some specific carbon to improve the hardness of the surface. This is the carbon. The problem is carbon is appear here. Carbon cause the micro crack between the steel and the carbon. If you put too much carbon, the hardness of the cast iron will get higher, but the cast iron get brittle, more brittle with the higher percent of carbon. And then due to the micro crack, too much carbon, too much micro crack, when you pull it, it's caused the separation of the steel grain. And that's caused the crack, okay, occur perpendicular to the line of force. That is 90 degrees to the line of force. So that is the application of the cast iron. Okay, don't worry. But when you consider to use it, you got to separate between types of material, which one is proper for some application, such as steel is no good for the rail, but steel is good for reinforcing the concrete. And in the opposite, cast iron is good for the rail, but it's no good to reinforce the concrete because it's brittle material. Concrete is brittle material. If brittle material stay with the brittle material, that is no good, okay? And then for the material that has no clear yielding point, we got to use the 0% offset, okay? Follow the Thailand industrial standard. What kind of material? High strength steel. Let's say if we talking about the P stainless wire, this is a kind of high strength steel. It has the yielding stress larger than 1,000 megapascal, or 4 times larger than the reinforcing steel. Also, the aluminum, let's put it aluminum alloy, okay? This also have the yielding of 400 megapascal. If the unclear yielding point, okay, occur, we got to specify 0.2%. 0.2% is 0.2 divided by 100. So it's going to be 0.002. This is 0.001. This is 0.002. You mark the line parallel to the first portion of the stress strain diagram linear portion. and then you can determine the yielding point of this material. Okay, and then this is a real example of the stress strain diagram of the high strength steel. Okay, you can see this one has no clear yielding point. So what is going to be point 002? It's going to be over here. Okay, and then when you mark it, you will get the yielding. That is like sigma sub y approximately. This is 450. Let's say this is 475 megapascal approximately. And then you can see the 0.2% offset have the application for this kind of high strength steel. Okay, and the author, you're supposed to be able to determine the ultimate stress. The fracture stress, ultimate stress is here, that is going to be, this is going to be sigma sub f. And then if you load the material passing through the yielding, what happened? When you release the load, the graph will not follow the original part. It will follow the new one over here. And then what we have is we have this kind of strain recovery, and we have this kind of strain plastic. As I show you over here, that is permanent set. So we have this one as the strain permanent, and strain permanent is going to be strain plastic minus strain recovery. And again, we have sigma equal to E strain. When strain recovery occur, the return is linear elastic. Strain recovery will be strain plastic divided by E. So you may compute this one and plug into this one. But for the strain plastic, you got to leak it. You got to leak it from the diagram. Okay, you got to leak it. This one, you read from stress strain diagram. And this one you may compute now. As I show you guys from the plastic, you will find the permanent set, okay, following this. And then there is stress strain behavior of the brittle material. As I mentioned to you guys, there is micro crack between the steel and carbon in the cast iron. Okay, when you cook it, the micro crack open and the failure is brittle. But when you compress it, the micro crack close up to each other. And also there is the Poisson effect. So in compression, cast iron can take very large force. And that is good in the application such as for the railways. Okay, and also the concrete made with cement paste, sand, and cast stone. And then there is a lot of crack between them during the manufacturing and during it, what's so called hydration process to harden. And what occur when you cook it, the micro crack open quickly. So concrete can take only 10% to 20% of the compressive force, of the compressive strength. In the compression, again, the micro crack cross up to each other. Now the concrete can take very large compressive stress compared to the tensile stress. And then should be the last one, stress strain diagram is a kind of signature for each material. It can tell us which material is brittle, which material is ductile. And following this, cast iron is brittle in tension. Wood also brittle. There is no yielding and the failure occur immediately when it reaches the fracture And for the aluminum, okay, you can see the aluminum is supposed to have the curve something like this. The steel also have very large stress than the aircraft. So that those materials are ductile materials. And also the material that's used for the tension member, most of the time we use the ductile material for the tension member. But for the compression member, you may use both. Okay, whether ductile or material can be used in compression. So that we use the steel in reinforced concrete to resist the compression in the column. And then when you check for the stiffness, we check for the slope. Okay, which material is the stiffest one? This is supposed to be the stiffest one because it has the largest slope. And this is the softest one since the slope so small compared to the other materials. So that's all for today. Next time I will come up with the example and I also take one of the midterm examination problem for the mechanics of material to review you guys how to find the mechanical property. And then later, how to use that mechanical property in the calculation of deformation of a simple structure, okay? So that's all for today. Thank you.